I hope you did you have your coffee yet? We get a whole bunch of, sorry, I have to stand here, I hear. We got a whole line of talks lined up for you. We start first with Christoph Munch-Tegeder.
Yes.
I said it correctly? Okay. So he's going to talk about all the different client authentication methods we have and all the ins and outs, and especially what you shouldn't do. So you got some more stories. Okay.
Yeah, good morning. I'm Christoph. I work with Second Quadrant as a consultant, and I do most of my work at customer sites, helping users figure out how to configure their Postgres, how to tune their Postgres for performance, and so on. And one of the things most people neglect is authentication. And so, yeah, I thought I'd get some of that more out in the open. It's all in the documentation, but nobody reads the documentation because documentation is boring. Let's find it out ourselves. So, yeah, let's start. Authentication. Why should we authenticate? It's complicated. You have to configure it. It's inflexible. Nobody knows where my database is. Nobody will target us. That's all the stuff one hears. But really, people are out for databases. For example, the Philippines election database was more or less stolen. Or no password database error. That's just the thing we are talking about here. And that even became a business model. People are, yeah, I can't say hacking databases, they are just connected to databases and copying out the data, deleting the database content, and demanding ransom money for the people to get the data back. And that goes into the thousands of databases. In fact, that was MongoDB, but not the only one. And the hackers who did this just automated the whole task, find MongoDB databases, connect to them, extract the data, and leave a ransom note. And yeah, 27,000 databases in just a few hours is some number. And as I realized there is only a limited number of MongoDB databases, they diverted their business model and moved on to Elasticsearch and some other databases. And really, we do not want to have Postgres on that list too. So yeah, what do we do about that? So without authentication, that's not the kind of open data we want to have. We do not want to pay those criminals. Sometimes there are even regulations. For example, if you are handling payment data, you have to comply with PCI DSS or even more personal data like health-related data, where you have a really strong authentication. And you have regular audits where they really check if you have good authentication configured. And nobody wants to explain to his boss, yeah, we got our database hacked and now it's gone. So yeah, what do we do? We cannot even hide our database. There are specialized search engines to find some kinds of products. This is a screenshot of Shodan. This shows a MongoDB database. When I searched on Shodan for a Postgres database, they were all locked down, which is a good sign. There's another search engine, ZoomEye. You can really search for the products and for certain properties on those products and get the IP addresses, which I blanked out up there and see that. This P-Suite here shows that this is one of the hacked databases. So yeah, we cannot even hide our database. So we have to secure our database. The first thing, of course, is we set up network security, set up firewalls, anybody who can't connect to our database can't hack it. That's quite easy, just to get it out of the line of fire. And another plus point for Postgres is here, it listens on localhost by default only. So it's not that easy to get it on the net accidentally. You have to open it up to the right network. And yeah, but on localhost, it's not always usable. You want to have a database server which listens to some connects from the outside. So eventually, you have to open the listen addresses parameter and, to get your Postgres on the network. Other things to remember is using fine-grained access control. If you run your application as a database super user, and, there's nothing the database can do to defend itself against deletion or something like that. Always use a regular user which has only the needed permissions on the database. Of course, the application itself has to be secured also. For example, SQL injection, we can't do anything in the database against that, or have very limited ways to defend against SQL injection once the SQL comes to the database. And yeah, the point we want to talk about today is authenticate all the regular users. So you do know who your users are, and that's only your users who are connecting to the database. Some definitions about that. We have identification, that is more or less a declaration of identity. So if the client connects and says, I'm user 42, that's his identification. The authentication is a proof of identity with something you know or you have or you are, something you know, for example, passwords, in some way, client certificates and so on. Something you have is, for example, with two-factor authentication, if you have this FIDO keys, USB keys, or even the Google Authenticator app on your phone, and what you are is biometrics, which doesn't really apply for databases because the database is rarely scanning your eyes or reading your fingerprint. Some people say it's what you used to know and what you have forgotten, for example, the passwords, or what you had and have long lost, for example, the token, or what you have been, for example, if you have injured your fingers and the fingerprint reader can't read them anymore. So it's always a little interesting what you can use for authentication. Authorization is the next step in the chain. That is allowing someone to use an object in some way to have some action on that object. Postgres and all other databases do that with grant and revoke and so on. And role-level security is in the same area, but we are not talking about that today. And what we always want to have is some kind of audit log, who connected, perhaps who did what. Of course, we have to set that up correctly. Perhaps you can't log every select, but perhaps we want to log changes to the database so we do know when something was changed and who did change it and what was changed. That's what the log connections parameter is for, PG audit and some other parameters. But today we'll focus on the authentication, but because that's enough for today. Yeah. What can we use for authentication? What secrets do we have? We can have shared keys, that's like passwords. Both sides have to know the password or at least something derived on the password, like the password hash. That's a shared key. We have asymmetric keys, like client certificates, where the server side doesn't need to have the private part of the key. Only the client has a private key to the certificate, and that's one of the criteria to select your authentication on. How do you change secrets? If you have to roll over your authentication, perhaps because someone left your organization, you do not want to have every former admin to have all the passwords to your database. So there has to be some mechanism to change passwords, and you do not only have to change it on the database side, you have to change it in the application too, of course. And always remember, do not put your passwords or your private keys on GitHub. There has been an incident a few years ago where you really could use a GitHub code search for begin RSA private key and find tons of SSH keys and certificates, private keys and so on in GitHub, and you still can use regular search engines to find private keys. So you do not want to have your private key in some search engine or accessible by someone. It's easy to do. Just have it in your code and git add, git commit, git push, and boof, it's on GitHub. So yeah, careful with that. Do you backup your keys or don't you? If you do backup your keys, you can always recover quite easily. You just restore the backup and everything is there. But on the other hand, suddenly all your passwords are in your backup, so you have to guard your backups against unauthorized access. And if you do not backup your secrets, how do you restore your secrets if you have to restore your database? Restoring databases is sometimes not an easy task. There's a talk about later today. And everyone remembers the GitLab incident from last week. So yeah, that's a topic for itself. One way out of that are hardware security modules. Those are from small USB tokens to one or two rack units devices, which have private keys stored in them and only do operations on those private keys, but never ever release the private keys to the application. So you can preload this module with a private key and plug it in. And if that module is stolen or lost, you note that the key cannot be copied out of that. But on the other hand, if that module is the only place where your keys live, what do you do if the module is lost? Those small USB tokens are quite easily lost, or if it just stops working, is broken, it's hardware, and hardware always is broken after some time, sometimes quite short time. So even there you have to consider how to roll out new secrets, or perhaps if you can keep a backup of your keys somewhere out of the module, or have a second module or something like that. The security of your authentication, what you have to know about that, we have passive attacks on authentication, that is, if someone listens on the network and watches the traffic go by and yeah, grabs the password from that, authentication info of the net, and of course all other traffic. So if all your attacker wants is to have a look at the database, perhaps it's enough to listen to the traffic. He doesn't even have to break the authentication for that. And there are active attacks when traffic is redirected. That's not that common in your own data center, but sometimes internet routing goes wrong, or someone injects wrong routes, and suddenly they can intercept the authentication. It's especially interesting on wireless, where just everyone can set up a base station, so nobody does clear text on the Wi-Fi anymore, luckily. And of course, anyone who can intercept traffic could also modify the traffic. So there are some quite interesting attacks in there. As Martin Wicker once said, there's no safe authentication unless you authenticate against who you are authenticating first. So you do know who you are authenticating to, so that do not just play man in the middle and relay your password or something like that to the target. So getting to the point, this Postgres, we have a very flexible and highly configurable authentication system here. It's even well documented, but as I said, who reads our documentation? Everyone just uses what's already there. We have, depending on how Postgres is installed, up to 13 different authentication methods. And we can configure them per database, per user, per source network. So perhaps your production servers need the one type of authentication, and the admin network has another kind of authentication. We can even switch that around by connection type. The configuration for that is in the PGHBA conf, that's a host-based authentication configuration. And that file is always, for each connection, checked from top to bottom, and the first match wins. So that's the order you have to be aware of. And I've seen some of these files get really big with dozens, up to hundreds of different connections configured in there. And if you ask the admin if that's really needed, you have things like, we don't know, but nobody will take it out because something might break. So have documentation on your entries and check if they are really needed, or if the application for that has gone away, or if that was some temporary measure, just to keep only those aspects in there that you really need. And a side note, all the users have to exist in Postgres, so you have always to create user create role in Postgres. We do not have any user auto creation or something like that. We only delegate the authentication to some external provider or internal. So we cannot create users automatically because that would extend to user auto-deletion, and we can't just delete a user from Postgres because that user might still own some objects, and we can't have objects without an owner in the database. How does this authentication configuration look like? For example, the entry for IPv4 local connections. The first column is the type of connection. Host says it's all network connections. We have host SSL there for connections of IP with SSL on that. And we even have host no SSL, which are connections without SSL. The local exists on Unix platforms only. That's a local Unix socket. And we don't not have that on Windows. The second column is the database. There are a few special keywords in there, like all, that's all databases. We can have this add file notation that reads a list of databases from some file. Replication is the keyword for replication connections. Same users or same role is a keyword to get the same database as the role who is connecting. The next column, the third column, is the user column. Again, some special keywords. All is, again, all users. We can have the plus syntax for groups. And again, the add file syntax to read the list of users from a file. If for some reason someone wants to name his database or his user all or replication or something like that, you can always double quote the strings so they lose their special meaning. Or if you have spaces in database or usernames, you have to double quote them so they can get passed out of there. For non-local connections, we have the source network that can be IPv4 or IPv6. This is the IPv4 syntax. You always have to add the netmask either as this or as a dotted plot notation. The IPv6 syntax is the same. You have the network address and the netmask bandwidth. And the last column is the authentication method. In this case, it's MD5. and we can add some options to that, and yeah, we'll have a look at what we can do there. Some special cases, we have this pgident conf file that allows a mapping of external usernames to Postgres usernames. We'll need that, for example, with Kerberos or SSL. And we can have a different map per pghba conf line. The parameter in pghba conf is a map which selects the map in the pgident conf. And we have a full regular expression support in that file, so we do not do not have to add a line for every user. Perhaps we can do that by regular expression. And some examples, we have the map name, that's what goes into the map parameter. And we have the system username, that's the username which is delivered externally to Postgres. And the Postgres username, for example, this is for SSL connections, where we map the test user from external to SSL user in Postgres. Or with Kerberos, I've added a Kerberos map here. We have always the usernames with the realm, and we can extract the local part from the realm like this, with regular expression, and just have the first match here. it's not in typo that there's no closing slash. The slash is really not in the syntax. We only need the opening slash to mark the regular expression, but we do not need or do not have the closing slash back there. So for the second part, the authentication mechanisms, what do we have there? The most well-known, perhaps, is trust, but there's nothing like trust. Trust is no authentication at all. It just trusts what the client says he is. That is, we are just using identification. There's really no password, nothing. It's just, yeah, we have this user, they want to connect to that database, they are from the right network, so yeah, well, let's let them in. So obviously, that's not good for servers. This is exactly the configuration which leads to the no password error, which leaks suddenly whole country's election database. So yes, do not use this on servers. That trust is fine, for example, for testing when you're running regression tests from the Postgres source code. It's easier with trust, or sometimes in some embedded systems, when you do know that the database will never ever be connected to any network, but as we know, all those little things today suddenly grow network interfaces and are piece of the Internet of Things which should never have been connected to the Internet. So very careful with trust. In some configurations, trust appears in the initial pghba conf when you first initialize the Postgres cluster. That's somewhat fine because that's just a new installation which does not listen on the network. But please check if that's in there and change it to something more secure. Ident is the second mechanism which sometimes pops up in C configuration. The idea behind ident is that we connect back to the source host, to the client host, and ask that for the owner of the connection. That's the identification protocol from RFC 1413. So obviously from the low number we see that's quite old. IRC users might still know that protocol. It's not that common today anymore, luckily. That means that we have to open an additional TCP connection on every connection from a remote host, which obviously is some overhead which we could save. And it relies on the security of the source host. The source host can say anything about his users. So perhaps not a good idea. Even the standard itself says the identification protocol is not intended as an authorization or access control protocol. So, yeah, perhaps not the best idea for authentication. Quite often we see peer authentication. That works on local connections only, that is on the Unix socket connections with connection type local. We can read the system username from the Unix socket and do know which Unix user is connecting to the database. This is quite a nice idea because everyone who can fake the usernames on the Unix socket has already compromised the system and can most likely just compromise the Postgres as well because he's already a root. That's great for local administration. Many Linux distributions put that as the default for the Postgres user on the local Unix socket. So all maintenance jobs can just connect to the database if they're running locally. Yeah, it's as secure as the host itself is. But as it's only on the local socket, it's of limited use for a database server because a database server almost always has remote connections, and we can't use a peer for remote connections. In fact, if you have the peer key or keyboard on a host or host SSL or something like that connection, it gets converted to ident, and then we are back at the previous slide. So that yeah, is fine for local connections, but not for remote. The next thing in reject, as the name of this authentication mechanism says, that's just blacklisting. We explicitly reject this connection, no matter what we could see in authentication. We can use that to reject some users or one user of some set of users and allow all the others with a later line in pghba-conf. We can also use that to block access to the database during maintenance. We can just drop the reject line in pghba-conf and do a Postgres reload. With listener addresses, we would have to restart Postgres, but we can just reject all external connections and have the database server locked up without restarting the database server. As we do not get authenticated by this, I call this a non-authentication method. It just makes sure that nobody can connect if he matches that line. Password authentication, there is a little less known. Luckily, the password authentication method with a password keyword in pghba-conf, that's password authentication. We have the password hashes stored in Postgres, except if you have turned password encryption off in Postgres-conf, but you shouldn't do that. And the table where the hashes are stored is pg out ID, and this authentication method sends the passwords in clear over the network. So everyone who has a sniffer on the network, a TCP dump, Wireshark, something like that, can read the passwords on the network. So yeah, do not use that because we have MD5, which at least sends password hashes over the network, so you can't just read the password of the network. And MD5, that's this one. From the client side, nearly the same. We have, again, password authentication. The password hashes are stored in Postgres, same table. Again, stored as hashes unless you switch password encryption off, which you really shouldn't do. On the wire, we have this string, MD5, and the hash of password and username plus salt. The salt is switched on every connection. The salt is a 4-byte integer. So if you do the math, you get a replay attack after about 2 billion connections, when you have about 50% chance that exactly this salt has been used before, and then you can just reuse your a hash which you have captured from the network earlier. 2 billion connections is quite a lot in Postgres. But on the other hand, we are using MD5 hash even in this construction, and MD5 has been broken for quite some time now. It's quite easy to just construct something which gives the right value. So perhaps not that good anymore, but it's still better than plaintext password. We do know that sometimes people who are, or companies who are under regulations like PCI DSS get problems with their auditors because they say there's MD5 in the configuration, that's not allowed anymore. In most cases, the auditor doesn't really understand the Postgres authentication, but he sees this MD5 string and it's just, no, that's MD5, not allowed anymore. So sometimes we need something different. And we are still not authenticating the server, so if anybody manages to do a man-in-the-middle attack on your connection, they can just take over the connection. Next one, LDAP, the lightweight directory access protocol. If you look at the syntax, it's not that lightweight anymore, but if you have ever seen the X500 directory access protocol, this is an improvement. We are authenticating against an LDAP backend. The LDAP server is not included in Postgres, so we have to have some external infrastructure. For example, if you have some directory server in your organization, you can use that for that, or you can set up your own LDAP server. And we have two methods of authentication. We can do the simple authentication, the simple mode, where we use the credentials we get from the network, from the client, to authenticate to the LDAP server. And if that succeeds, we are fine. And we have the search and bind mode, where we are connecting to the LDAP server with our own credentials, with the Postgres server's credentials, and then search for the user matching the username and the password given from the client. We can use a TLS connection to the LDAP server, which is always a good idea, but we can do start TLS only. That's defined in the RFCs, in the standards for that. We do not do LDAP over SSL. The difference is that the TLS connection is like SMTP start TLS. We do a connection first and then send the start TLS to start the SSL negotiation on the connection. The other mode, LDAP over SSL, is where we do the SSL negotiation first and then start the LDAP protocol. That's not in the standard. But unluckily, some servers only do the mode which is not in the standard and do not support the mode which is in the standard, thanks Microsoft. So sometimes you have to look out what to do here. And there's one big problem with the LDAP authentication method. We have to send the database password from the client in clear text to the server, so the server can use that password when querying the LDAP server. We cannot send the password hash because the password hash is not what's stored on the LDAP server, or perhaps it's not stored in the right format, so we use the clear text password on the database connection. So we really want to use an SSL or TLS for the Postgres connection that we get the password out of the clear. In fact, without TLS for the Postgres connection, this is slightly worse than the MD5 mechanism, because in MD5 we have at least a salted hash of the password on the wire, and here it's suddenly clear text again. But it doesn't have the MD5 string in the configuration, which makes some auditors more happy because, as I said, they don't know Postgres authentication. We had one customer where the auditor really recommended using LDAP authentication over MD5 authentication. So, yeah, be aware of that. there's PAM, the pluggable authentication modules. That's mostly Linux-only technique, but Linux inherited this from Solaris back in the 90s, I think. And those modules, which are kind of plugins, handle authentication and sometimes even more. If you are using PUM for shelf, you do all the session setup with that. The configuration files are in etc pum.d or something similar. In most distributions, I know it's etc pum.d. Even if you're using PUM, you cannot access the system passwords because the system passwords are stored in etc shadow, which is readable by root only. And the Postgres server doesn't run as root. It will refuse if you try to run it as root. And you really shouldn't make etc shadow more readable by any other users. The great advantage of the PUM is we can use some modules which delay the next connection after a failed authentication attempt. We can have a counter which locks the account after a number of failed authentications, which is always really great. But again, we have the ptxt password on the network because we can't really know how the PUM module will use the password to authenticate. Do we have a ptxt list? Do we have some special hashes? Do we connect to another server? Whatever. So again, use TLS for the Postgres connection to get the ptxt password of the network. And there's GSS, the Generic Security Services API, that's these days used for example for Kerberos. That is what Postgres does. We use Kerberos 5. The Kerberos infrastructure, of course, the KDC and so on, is not included in Postgres. If you ever see Kerberos 4 in the wild, that's really outdated for about a decade now. With Kerberos, we get a whole new bunch of technology. We are suddenly talking of Realms, which is something like the Windows domain mostly. We have principles, which are the usernames. We have tickets, which are used for authentication. The ticket granting ticket, which is used to get the application specific ticket. And so on. So that's really a whole bunch of things which suddenly have to set up. And the authentication flow is that the client first authenticates to the key distribution center, the KDC, and gets his ticket there. We have the service server, the so-called, which is our database server because that's providing the service database. That also has to authenticate to the KDC. So the KDC is a source of trust in the system. And we need accurate times across all systems. If the times queue is too big, the tickets just won't match anymore. And we have a periodic ticket renewal that is every per default 8 hours. These tickets expire and you have to get a new ticket either by renewing the old ticket or by creating a new one. All these things are not handled by the Postgres library itself. Your application has to handle them, which doesn't really make things easier for the application. But on the other hand, we get the ptxt password of the network. We are only handling the tickets, and the tickets are themselves encrypted. And all entities, as the client as well as the Postgres server, are authenticated to the KDC, and everyone has to trust the KDC because that's how Kerberos works. That looks like a great idea, except for all the fuss with the Kerberos infrastructure. And of course, the Kerberos thing is really flexible on itself. We can have the KDC store the passwords in its own database, or on LDAP or something else. The client can use passwords to authenticate or use a PK init mechanism, which is a public key mechanism, or a bunch of other things. There are GitHub files, so-called, for all non-interactive processes. An interactive user can always enter his password. The GitHub file stores the secrets, so the application can read it from there. Which is again a stored secret, so that's one of the cases where you have really to think if you want to back up that file or if you are recreating it, if you have ever to store your database. And as the Kerberos principles look like this, we have the username @ and the realm name. In almost all cases, we are using pgident to map the system username, the Kerberos username to some Postgres username with like this regular expression here. On the Postgres side, that's really easy to configure. We just have to add the keytab file. Kerberos server key file is the parameter in Postgres conf. And in the PGHBA conf, we have just the GSS keyboard here, and we have to add the VIM, which we are authenticating against. And the client connection has to add the Kerberos server name, so they get the service name right. Once we have the Kerberos thing up and running, which can be a task on its own, the Postgres config is rather simple. Next mechanism, client certificates. Of course, it works only for SSL connections, so on host SSL. And the client verifies the server certificate, and the server verifies the client certificate. This requires, of course, public key infrastructure, which is not included in Postgres. Of course, you can always create some user certificates with OpenSSL and sign them, but that doesn't really scale. That gets a hassle. So there is real CA software, like TinyCA, OpenPKX, and something like that, which you should use for that. The minimal server configuration is that we switch SSL on, add the server certificates, and we need the user CA, which signs all the user certificates. I do not recommend to reuse the server CA for the user certificates, as that's another entity which says these are valid users, which are quite distinct from servers. But we do not need to buy some expensive external CA services. We can just roll our own CA for the users. And then we have the client connections where we have to add the certificate and the SSL key. So the SSL authentication works. Again, the private keys are really important secrets. You do not want to leak them. So yeah, backup or not to backup. Client certificates expire, but you can just change the certificate, and on the next connection, the new certificate will be used. The server certificates and the CAs expire too. To change those on the server side, you need to restart Postgres, which is not that elegant, but yeah, there we are. To revoke a client certificate, if it gets lost or something like that, there are certificate revocation lists, the SSL CRL file parameter in Postgres conf. Before Postgres 10, that is for all Postgres versions, changing the CRL requires a Postgres restart, which is yeah, not that elegant, but the patch is already in, so that will be resolved later this year. And we map the com name of the client certificate to the Postgres user. Like this is a common name, the CN of the client certificate is test user. The Postgres username will be mapped to SSL user, like this. Some other mechanisms, radios, remote authentication, dial-in user service. As the name says, that's mostly in telecommunications environments. Quite uncommon these days. I've never seen that outside of telecommunications equipment. Then there's SSPI, that's a security support provider interface. That's a Windows-only thing. So it's only available in Postgres on Windows. That's a Windows sign-on, single sign-on mechanism with Kerberos and fallback via the NTLM hashes. And we have BSD out. That's OpenBSD authentication framework. That only exists on OpenBSD, but is basically like the pluggable authentication modules. Some final considerations for authentication on TLS. If you are using TLS, the default cipher list is much too broad. It's medium and high, and so we get some goodies like ARC4 MD5 in there, which really shouldn't be used. So you should get a better cipher list. But if you are, for example, using Java software, make sure your Java speaks TLS cipher list you selected. You can and should generate your own Diffie-Hellman parameters with, for example, the OpenSSL GenDH, because the built-ins are the defaults, which are used since 20 years about now. Recent Postgres with recent OpenSSL even supports ECC as ECDSA. So you can use an elliptic curve certificate, which makes the keys much shorter. In any case, the setup for a new connection is much more expensive than without TLS, because of course we have to do all this key exchange thing and the asymmetric keys, which require quite some compute power. But once a connection is up, we have only the overhead for the symmetric cipher, which really isn't that high for modern CPU anymore. If you use a connection pooler, you have to be aware the client can only authenticate to the pooler. PGBouncer has a mode where the client authentication is passed through to the server, and the pooler always authenticates its own connection to the database. forwarding authentication works only with plaintext passwords, so not that intelligent. And if you are using TLS, the TLS connection gets terminated on the pooler, and we can use another TLS connection between the pooler and the database, or have a plaintext connection between the pooler and the database, depending on the setup. If the pooler is running on the same host as the database, the plaintext connection to the database won't hurt. But if the pooler is on its own host, we have to set up a second pair of certificates. So in summary, always secure your databases, else you have the wrong kind of open data. Always authenticate your clients. That protects from the no password error, which leaks 100 million database entries. And authenticate the servers, for example, with server certificates. The minimum you can do is using passwords. And yeah, use TLS connections whenever possible, because that's the cheapest way to get all the plaintext off the network. And if you're using SSL, always verify all certificates. That is, the server certificates should be verified too. Questions?
Yeah, if you have any questions, let me come to you with the microphone, because we're all recording this, and everybody wants to hear you, so.
Hi, first, beautiful talk, thanks a lot. I have a question. I found, when you set up a new Postgres database and you configure the PG-HP-aided file, it's very easy to create a setting where you think you have a username with MD5 hash set, but it's actually no password because you accidentally switched one tab to the right. So it's a very kind of sloppy file parsing, and it doesn't give a warning. Is there a way to make this stricter?
Oh, good question. I always use spaces.
Okay. So I get a typical beginner's error, basically, but so I would wish to have a simple security check. Is it possible to log in without any password into your database, yes or no?
You can always try that with PSQL, the command line client, and just give no password or connect and check whether it asks for password.
So I have to test by hand, basically.
Yes, but so it should be easy to write something. So perhaps if I have some time on the way home, a good idea.
Okay. Thanks.
Any other questions over there?
Yeah, thanks for this talk. I agree that the config of the HBA is not so nice. It would also be nice if we would code check that we could check that a line would never be hit, right? If there's a host all trust, then the host all the first match, we could do something nice with that. So we might should code that. But is there what TLS version actually is used in Postgres? And is there something like session resumption or planning for TLS 1.3?
There is no session cage right now, and we use the TLS version which we get from OpenSSL and the cipher list. So if you configure the right cipher list, you get a TLS 1.2 cipher, and OpenSSL does 1.2. It's all OpenSSL down there.
Okay.
Any other questions? Over here? Okay, after that I will come to you.
Yes, my question is with the PGABH, you can specify the same user for a database. What if you are in an environment like shared hosting where a customer wants to have multiple databases? Can you specify the schema where a database is put in with something like same user?
No, there is a user schema parameter in PostgreSQL, but that basically switches the password hashing off, which is not really what we want. I think you could work with pgidentmap to get something like that. Okay. That should work, but I've never tried that.
Okay.
So there was one question on this side over there. Okay.
So thank you for your talk as well. Are there any plans on OCSP support with certificate of authentication? Can have some problems otherwise, I've heard, but yeah, instead of reloading CRLs.
I know that some people are working on the whole authentication stuff. For example, the MD5 is going out. The CRL reload was added. I think OCSP would be next. And yeah, I think it's a matter of developer time. You just need to find a developer who has enough time for that, because all of them are quite busy. Or send patches. It's open source.
Hi, thank you for the talk as well. Question about the client certificate authentication method. You said it now uses common name fields from the client certificate to authenticate certificate. Is it also possible to specify the issuer, the issuing CA?
That happens with the user CA parameter because you have only one CA in the PostgreSQL for verify user certificates.
Okay, so you would only be able to use one CA to verify user certificates. You could not use different CAs.
I believe it's only one CA, but I've never tried to put multiple CA certificates in the user CA file. I would expect it to fail. I think Stephen has some information on that.
Does Stephen want to comment on that? Okay, I'll give you the mic.
So it's actually possible to have multiple CAs and be able to use multiple CAs with client search. We don't currently have a way of specifying the issuing authority, though. So not sure who had the question, but you can't specify per issuing CA currently, unfortunately. It's an interesting idea, though. I agree that would probably be good, especially when you have like cross-line CAs and other stuff like that where that matters, but we can't today. Yeah, it just is based on the common name.
All right, good question. Any more questions? Right here.
So regarding the pghba.conf, you mentioned don't use passwords because it can be sniffed, and you know the preferred method is the MD5, and that all makes sense. I was just wondering, why hasn't the password, which is a little bit weak option, why hasn't that been deprecated, or is that something they're talking about, or because it's the sort of thing a rookie DBA might make, and then suddenly you've got very bad news for Postgres if you know, someone's been hacked.
I think never. No one removes code unless there's a strong incentive to do that. So perhaps one should just give a little push on the mailing list. Even I, before I researched this, thought that the password thing was out, but oops, it's still there.
Okay. Well, I mean, it's a suggestion. It is something which someone, you think password sounds secure, but it can be easily hacked.
Yes. I think perhaps he needs that if he set password encryption to off or the user schema to on, where we can't use hashed passwords because the password representation on server and host client starts to differ. So perhaps it's used there, but as I said, avoids it at all costs.
Just you mentioned that MD5 is not good. Everyone knows the drawbacks of it, and it's not made for storing passwords, but just to compare stuff. So why isn't it replaced with a more appropriate hashing algorithm for verifying passwords?
People are working on that, so I would expect it to be improved in Postgres 10, but the patch is passed back and forth and it's not been applied yet. But there is a patch and people are working on that.
I just have a comment. The MD5 is not the regular MD5, it's a stretched and hashed, what's it called, recycled one. So it's not the usual problems with MD5, just the name.
Yeah, but that doesn't help you with the auditor. And even if it has been improved, we should use to something really modern and get rid of the name so nobody gets bad ideas.
One more question there? Okay. I think we have time for one last question.
Unfortunately, that's not a question. Just a new comment about MD5. I think it should be removed at all, and we should use something modern like TLS or something else, because just hashing doesn't help for man-in-the-middle attacks and other bunch of all kinds of attacks. So I suggest to not use it at all.
If possible, use TLS, as I said. Unluckily, some client libraries can't speak TLS, so...
it means that in that case, you shouldn't expose server to the public infrastructure.
Yes, of course.
All right. No more questions? I think we're almost already out of time, actually. So thank you, Christoph. Okay, I think we got 3 minutes to...